Hey, I'm Ira. Today I'm going to answer that burning question. What if Meatloaf's 1977 album, Bat Out of Hell, had been heavily inspired by the 1985 animated film Rainbow Bright and the Star Stealer? Okay, I realize that's not a super compelling question, so here's the answer. Keep watching anyway. Today's cover art is inspired by an album I spent my teenage years feeling very guilty for loving. Meatloaf's melodramatic masterpiece, Bat Out of Hell, is very close to my heart, and I can think of no better way to pay tribute to all those songs than to completely degrade the album art. Let's get started by getting to know the artist behind the work. The guy's name is Richard Corbin. He's best known for making paintings that fit in the genre of, I guess you'd call it, adult fantasy. You know, it's that whole heavy metal magazine aesthetic, barbarians, giant lizard people, lots of swords, and lots of veiny muscles. Let's talk about the painting he made for the Meatloaf album. It's basically Bruce Springsteen's Born to Run meets Conan the Barbarian. On the cover, we've got a naked biker dude shooting up out of a grave, and in the background, we've got a bat standing on a mausoleum who's clearly the groundskeeper at the cemetery, and he's really upset this troublemaker is ruining his landscaping. The bat's like, "You know how long it's going to take me to reseed this grass?" I picked this album cover for a couple of reasons. One, it's obviously something that stuck with me as a kid. I'd never seen anything like it before, and like it or not, it's a pretty memorable image. Two, it seemed like a fun challenge to try and draw a motorcycle, something I don't draw very often, and a person with their back arched in a really extreme way, also something I don't draw often. Third reason I picked this is I love Corbin's use of color. Super saturated, super cartoonish. I love it, and I'm always looking for an excuse to get super extreme with color. So when you're creating a piece of narrative art, it's always really important to understand the compositional choices you're making. So if I'm going to reference another artist's composition, I want to understand how they're coming at the piece. And composition basically means the arrangement of the visual elements, how it all fits together, and at the base of all that is the perspective that they're looking at the scene from. Before I start drawing any of the elements of the scene, I'm going to establish the point of view and perspective. So I start to mark out some sort of loose perspective grid on my page. Then I begin blocking out the forms, making sure they're positioned at the right angle in the context of the perspective grid. What I learned in the last episode of cover art when I was drawing the Ramones cover is that it's important for me to get really comfortable with the composition by basically redrawing the whole thing as it is. I'm not going to make any creative choices at this point, and actually that frees my mind up to just wander and come up with ideas that I can use later. So as I'm sketching here, I'm thinking about how the original album came out in 1977, and by the time I was a little kid in the mid-80s, this whole weird sword and sorcery aesthetic had really filtered down from the elitist peak of the underground to mainstream media like kids cartooning and Saturday morning. So by the mid-80s, you're seeing He-Man and Thundercats, things really inspired by that 70s fantasy look. He-Man and Thundercats, obvious points of reference if I'm working with a really manly looking man. But the point of reference here that's really drawing my interest is the cool horse bike. And when I think of flying horse bikes, my mind goes to that 1985 epic classic, Rainbow Bright and Star Stealer. Wake up! Fun fact, did you know that Rainbow Bright started out as a Hallmark card? Yeah, it's true. So, what character sprung to mind when I began sketching a flying motorcycle horse? Obviously, it's my pal here, Onyx, the flying robot horse. Onyx is a very good boy who flies all over the universe. Check out this awesome concept art from the movie. Concept art is always my favorite way to look into the behind the scenes of a project. Now, surprisingly, there's not a huge fandom for Onyx. I'm not the only one, though. I went on Pinterest and found this Microsoft Word painting. So, you know, I'm not alone out there with my love for Onyx. But I'm only using my favorite horse as a jumping off point for the design. I'm going to really just re-envision the motorcycle, retain some of what was already there, bring something new to it. I'm keeping the basic design of Onyx's head, but then blending the traditional motorcycle parts with a more streamlined look of the robot horse. Let's switch out the naked biker for the antagonist of the Rainbow Bright movie. A villain named the Dark Princess. That's all her name is, just Dark Princess. Very, very creative. I think she's got a pretty cool look that's going to add some interesting elements to this design, especially her hair. I can really use it to create a sense of motion. Now, regarding her outfit, I always thought her character had an aesthetic connection with Onyx. And I remember watching this movie and thinking, Onyx's backstory is that he's probably her horse originally, and maybe they had a conflict of interest, or like he had a shift in morality and joined the side of good. I obviously did a lot more thinking about this movie than the filmmakers themselves. And here I am 30 years later, still speculating on this deep, rich narrative. Some might say I overplan my sketches and I should work a little looser, but for a composition like this, where I'm drawing things that I don't draw often, I want to be confident in what I'm doing, especially when it comes to drawing mechanical objects that have to have a sense of logic about them, and also complicated body poses that I'm not really that familiar with. The inking stage is when I start to see my style really take over the project. This is no longer just a copy of the original image. I am paying tribute to it, though, like I said, but it's a very specific type of tribute. And I came up with a word to describe my process of reinterpreting someone else's art. I came up with the word cartoonify, which basically means searching for a traditional cartoon appeal, simplifying visuals, exaggerating emotions all through black line art, which is an overly complicated way of saying, I'm going to take this thing and I'm going to make it fun. What do I mean by fun? I guess I just mean like easier on the eyes. Actually, we're coming up to a good example here. Check out this inked version of the biker's face. It's fine, I guess. It's a clear tribute to the original, but it's just not fun to look at. So, I'm going to go in and change it. I'm actually going to go back and resketch the whole character head. I'm realizing I don't really like the full-on profile that they use in the original album art, so I'm going to go to turn the head slightly towards the viewer, just a little bit. I'm going to redesign the nose and the lips of the character. Okay, now I'm happy with this. She's got a good glam rock appeal. It was kind of missing from the original. And given that this is sort of a glam rock album, I think actually my character is a much better fit for the album art. Before we go any further, do you love me? Will you love me forever? Do you think maybe I should call Meatloaf and see if he wants to take a look at it? Can somebody get Meatloaf on the phone? Now that I've finished inking the main subject here, the pressure is off. And I find that I can actually loosen up a bit with my line art, because the rest of the scene is things I'm more comfortable drawing. I'm going to really cartoonify this bat here, make him a lot less intimidating. Instead of going, now he's kind of going like, which is more my vibe, I think. Then I'm going to turn all the gravestones into crystals, which makes this whole planet now a cool alien world, and I think Richard Corbin would be very into that. When setting up my base colors, I usually color my character first, and I try to limit my color range. In this case, I'm working with grays for the robot horse, red, orange, and yellow colors for the character, with just a touch of teal, but not too much. Now, to make this main character stand out, I respond to this color scheme with compliments. In this case, that's going to be cool colors. So in the background, I'm using greens for the sky to make that red-orange color pop. And I'm using blues and purples for the landscape. You know, in another life, I think I would have been really good at branding kids' candy. That's what all my colors feel like. After the base colors, I'm going to move on to the lighting effects. And I really love the lighting effects of the original, the shadows, the textures. 70s fantasy art always has like the best shadows and lighting. In fact, studying this era of like hyper-realistic fantasy art has really taught me a lot about how to create atmosphere in a composition. So that's why this is such a good exercise here. For example, in the original album art, there's this awesome low-hanging fog. This kind of frosty-looking energy bursting out of the bike. And this great cloud form that Mr. Corbin used to, I guess, break up the red of the sky. And I'm going to take all these environmental effects and recreate them in my scene. Just using my own color palette. From there, I do some more refining, mostly shadows to bring out a little more contrast in the scene. I often do a last run of shadow effects over a scene just to bring out the drama. I really like the idea of taking a super cartoony scene and bringing a lot of dramatic lighting to it. That's a thing I enjoy. And like a bat out of hell, I'm done with this thing. What do you think?
Tonight, there's a man in the shadows with a gun in his eye and a blade shining no so bright. There's evil in the air and there's thunder in the sky and a killer's on the bloodshot streets. On down in the tunnel with a deadly horizon, oh, I swear I saw a young boy down in the gutter. He was starting to foam in the heat.
That's pretty much all for this episode, but I just like to let you know that cover art is made possible by my Patreon page. If you want to help me make more episodes, click the link in the description and you'll get early access to videos plus sneak peeks and behind the scenes process posts and more cool stuff that I'll come up with as we go. I've got more ridiculous tributes to famous art in store, so make sure you subscribe to follow along. And believe it or not, I teach actual classes on cartooning and concept art. You can find them at the amazing learning site Skillshare. Use the link in the description to sign up and you'll get a few free months of access to my classes, plus all the other great things Skillshare has to offer. But for now, I'm Ira Marks, this is Cover Art, and I'll see you next time.